Good morning, Dave Birch. You're one of the keynote speakers during the Dutch Bitcoin conference, and you know all about secure electronic transactions. Please explain what is your background.
My background is consultancy, so I work for Consult Hyperion, which is a very specialist electronic transactions consultancy. And we work for the larger organizations. Our clients are Barclays and Visa and MasterCard and Transport for London and so on, helping them to use new technology to perform transactional services more effectively. So I'm very interested in the practicalities of how you do real transactions on the internet and in electronic spaces. And as I'm sure many people will have reflected, one of the barriers to doing more effective transactions in that online space is identity. Identity is a problem.
Okay, and obviously I think you answered the question on stage that it is helping, but can you explain
why? I feel that it could help.
Yes.
And the reason I think that is because we need a mechanism for keeping our identities safe and secure and under lock and key, but transacting with each other with security. And the way to do that, I'm sure you've heard the phrase before about reputational commerce.
Yes.
The way to do that is to interact with virtual identities in a way that assesses reputation. So for example, you might want to come to my website, but you can only come to my website if you're over 18 and resident of the EU. Well, knowing that you're over 18 and resident of the EU is not the same as knowing who you are. If I have to ask who you are, there's two problems with that. First of all, your privacy is violated because it's none of my business who you are. But secondly, now I know who you are, so now I'm another place where your identity can be stolen from, right?
Okay.
So what we want to do is find a way to say, so that you can show me that you're over 18 and resident in the EU, but not who you are, okay? And the way we do that is through, you know, virtual identities that contain reputations. The English word is pseudonymous
okay.
transactions,
yes.
Which means that somebody knows who the transaction participants are, but they don't. So in other words, you could show me something from your bank which says you're over 18, and I don't know who you are, but I know that the bank knows who you are.
So that would be sufficient.
That's good enough. That's
yes.
sufficient, and
yes.
we can have the transaction. So we take these kind of reputations that we're going to use to make more and more efficient online interactions. But where do we put them? Where do I put that?
Storage problem, basically.
Well, yeah, it's got to be somewhere that is secure and trusted and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
So you could store that in the bank. And then when I want to know, you could point me to the bank and I go and ask the bank and blah, blah, blah. Or you could store, you know, there might be other kinds that shops or sports clubs or all sorts of things might want to store. And that could work. That's the Fed, you know, what we would call the federation yeah. solution to identity. But that's been around for years and it hasn't happened. Because managing these identities and looking after them is a problem. So this is why this idea is coming around. Well, what if we could find the right structure to put those things on the blockchain?
Yes.
And have it managed by everybody instead of somebody in a very secure manner. I mean, one of the appealing things about this new branch of technology is that it means that records can't be tampered with and changed and this sort of thing. And the answer to that, I think, is actually this might be the way forward. So when you want to show me that you're over 18, you don't point me to the bank, you point me to the blockchain. And I can see the record there and I can see that, oh, okay, ABN said you were over 18 and blah, blah, blah. And maybe this is a better way of doing things.
Okay. During your presentation, you said smart contracts is a wrong word. It's poorly misnamed. The smart contract has a lot of attention this week because of the hack of 60
it
million.
It does, yeah, yeah.
Why is smart contract poorly misnamed?
Well, the problem is the word contract. So in English, and I'm sure the equivalent in Dutch, contract means something specifically. It means a legal agreement between two parties. I mean, that's not what a smart contract, and in particular the smart contract on the Ethereum, the smart contract on the blockchain is a program, it's an application. It's a new kind of application that we haven't had before. It's a very interesting and very powerful kind of application. And right now, I'm sure people are coming up with some amazing things to do with those applications. But they're not contracts, right?
Okay.
And so I think when people saw the word contract, they imagined it had some sort of legal backing, and it really doesn't. So I don't like the word smart contract. I think, you know, shared ledger application or distributed application is a much better way of thinking about it. But it also, I think, conveys something about why there's excitement in that space.
Mm-hmm.
The reason that computers are amazing is because you can run applications on them that will do anything. Like, once you've got the computer, you can write applications that do incredible things, right?
Yes.
And I think the same is true in this space. The one way of thinking about the shared ledger is as a new kind of computer, a consensus computer, that allows people to share a world view, right, without trusting any particular person in the middle. And just the same way that running applications on a computer can do amazing things, running these shared applications on this shared ledger will also do incredible, amazing things, which I am too old to think of, but I'm sure there are people in garages right now coming up with amazing stuff in that space.
Okay.
So they're really, really exciting, but I think the word contracts misleads. It doesn't explain why they're exciting. They're exciting because they're applications.
Okay. And do you think that blockchain is the main technology for the coming years, or is it just a start? And will other technologies that...
Yeah, I tend to think it's the start. So I understand all of the reasons why the particular Bitcoin blockchain, which has some incredible capabilities,
mm-hmm.
But it seems to me like unlikely that the first attempt at a global shared ledger is the optimum version of the technology. Like the first version of the steam engine wasn't the best kind of steam engine. You know, the first version of the electric car wasn't the best kind of electric car. So I strongly suspect that there are people now working on new kinds of shared ledgers, which will be more optimal for some specific purposes. So, but I think we should seize on the permissionless innovation afforded by the Bitcoin blockchain to experiment and create amazing new things. If you were a company, would you put your next 20 years of corporate existence into a new data structure that might still have bugs in it, we don't even know, where the consensus is by mining pools that are not, you have no idea who's in these mining pools or what they're doing. You know, if you wake up in the morning and all of a sudden your transactions aren't going through, they're all just sitting in the memory pool, and who are you going to call? Like, wait a second, why aren't any of my stocks and shares getting traded? That doesn't seem right to me.
Okay.
So I think, yes, I think the sense of your question is correct. You know, this is a fantastic new technology. I do believe that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the first instance. And even now, I'm sure somebody is coming up with a better idea, better way of doing it.
And did you see the blockchain coming, say, 10 years ago? Not literally the blockchain,
no,
but
I didn't. And, you know, we were working on the electronic cash technologies of the time.
Yes.
So a lot of the components of the blockchain actually come from a long time ago.
Okay.
So there were early attempts, actually here in the Netherlands, there were early attempts to build electronic cash systems for the internet.
Yes.
David Chomes, eCash, and this kind of thing.
It was right here in Amsterdam.
It was right here in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
And so some of the techniques from that around the use of public key cryptography, Adam Back's Hashcash, which played a huge role in the evolution of this, I was very familiar with all of those. But no, I wasn't smart enough to be able to put those components together to make this new way of transferring value. It is a genuine breakthrough in the technological space. All I'm reflecting on is saying, well, you know, the first steam engine was an amazing breakthrough in the technological space, but the steam engines that we put on wheels and drove around for trains, it wasn't the same steam engine as that first steam engine.
Okay.
You know, people built new ways of condensing steam and all this sort of stuff. And the blockchain, the current Bitcoin blockchain, is phenomenally inefficient because it's optimized for one particular role, and it's not obvious to me that's the, you know, that will be the same for everybody.
Okay, so we still have a lot of new developments and trends coming up in the Bitcoin and blockchain
scene. I really do feel that's true, and I think that as we move further away from the Bitcoin blockchain was built around this very specific value transfer and the idea of this currency, and I'm not sure I buy all of that.
Okay,
I'm unconvinced about Bitcoin as a currency. I'm unconvinced about Bitcoin as a payment system. But the guy who was supposedly is Satoshi Nakamoto, the Australian guy, Craig Wright, in one of his last blog posts, they've all been deleted now, but in one of his last blog posts, he described the Bitcoin blockchain as a global security service. Not as a currency, not as a commodity, okay, not as a payment system, but as a security service. And I sort of, to me, that resonates. I feel that's closer to the truth of this infrastructure.
So we should distinguish between the Bitcoin as a currency, as a value, and the blockchain technology.
And the blockchain technology could have some amazing applications. It's not obvious to me that any of them would be payments.
Okay. Well, thank you for sharing your thoughts with us. And
thank you for listening to my crazy ideas.
No, they're not crazy, I'm sure. So thank you very much, David.
Thank you.